So some interesting things about Jesus is, first of all, of course, the New Testament, when you read it, there's 27 books in the New Testament that give a very accurate and historically accurate description of Jesus. They talk about things that are around that time that you can verify and look at and see that these are historically accurate depictions. But not only does the Bible talk about Jesus, and I could talk quite a bit about what's amazing about the Bible, and I'll just throw out a couple things before we move on to the non-biblical topics. Of the historical sources, when you're going to look at somebody who existed in the past, let's say somebody came to you and said, Shakespeare never existed. You know, that's actually a debate. You may or may not know this, but some people claim that Shakespeare never existed. And so, well, how do you answer that question? Because we can't go touch him today, right? So how is it that you're going to find out whether somebody who's making the claim that Shakespeare never existed, how can you investigate that? Well, you have to go and look at the historical evidence. So you go and look to see what, was there anything that he did or people who were friends of his, any writings or any artifacts that were left behind. You go and see other people who were writing back in those ages, historians from that time period. Did they talk about him? How many of them talked about him? Now, Julius Caesar, has anybody here ever heard of Julius Caesar? Does anybody here doubt that Julius Caesar existed? Anybody? Well, why don't you doubt that he existed? Why? Because, first of all, you were taught about him in school, and so you believed it, right? Well, you believed it because there is historical evidence. There is writings and histories and things that describe Julius Caesar. Well, do you know that there is approximately 10,000 times more documents that describe Jesus historically than Julius Caesar? The evidence for Jesus' existence is like up here. Julius Caesar is actually, I pick him out because he has quite a bit of historical evidence. He has somewhere around 500 documents and various pieces of history. And I said 10,000 times more. But actually, Jesus has on the order of 20,000 historical documents that demonstrate and talk about him. Some of those are biblical texts, and some of them are non-biblical texts, like Tacitus. Okay, he was a Roman historian who lived in the first century. He was born in 52 AD. Anybody know what year Jesus was born in? Yeah, somewhere around 4. You know, you would think 0, but the guy who came up with the dates messed up a little bit. because, interestingly enough, at that time, they didn't have the number 0 when he was introducing the year of Christ. And so 0 wasn't a concept yet at that point. So he got that off by 1 year because 1 was the year of his birth, because there was no 0. And then he made a few other mistakes. But so somewhere around 2 to 3, 4 AD. But this guy, Tacitus, was a Roman historian. Now, let me ask you this. Were the Romans generally pro-Christian by AD 52? No, absolutely not. They were, the Christians and the Jews at that point were enemies. The Romans conquered their territory, but this Roman who wasn't a Christian, who wasn't even in favor of Christians, wrote this about Jesus and he said that Jesus was in fact crucified by Pontius Pilate. Pontius Pilate was a Roman leader, so he would add that. But he also describes other aspects of Jesus' life. Okay, so we have this testimony. Now also, Flavius Josephus, who was born a little bit earlier, AD 37, wrote about Jesus. Now, if you are aware, what about the relationship between Jews and Christians come around AD 50? Are they in favorable relationship or non-favorable?
Non-favorable.
If you remember, there was this one guy, Saul, who was a Jewish man. And in fact, Jesus was Jewish. All of the apostles were Jewish. But then they began to view these people as heretics. They were members of a sect. They were being led astray. And so Paul, who was a very gung-ho Jewish person, he went and started persecuting and jailing Christians because he was trying to stamp out this falsehood. But this man, Flavius Josephus, who was himself a Jew and not a Christian, wrote about Jesus and described him as a wise man who did amazing miracles. Okay, so this is not somebody written as somebody who's on Jesus' side, but this is somebody who would be somewhat opposed to Christians in general, but it was so commonly known at that point, you couldn't write and say, well, he didn't do any miracles, because everybody knew that he did miracles. And so Flavius Josephus wrote this and said he was a wise man, did amazing miracles, he was crucified, and then he rose from the dead in 3 days. That's pretty good, solid historical evidence. Then there is a number of other historians, both Greek and Roman. I just listed their names. We can look at them sometime in the future if you want to really get into this sometime. I love talking about this stuff, but today we don't have the time. So we're moving right along. Also, the Jewish Talmuds, which are writings, they're extra-biblical, but they're the Jewish scholars and leaders would write these things about historical and also understanding how to understand the scripture. So they write about Jesus. And as I said, there is more historical evidence for Jesus than for Julius Caesar. So there's no question. There's some very solid things that we need to be able to know that Jesus lived in history. Not only that, he did miracles. And we're going to look at some more of the evidence for him rising from the dead. But here is some historical evidence from third parties who testified that Jesus rose from the dead. Okay? So let's move on now. So not only did Jesus live in history, he was like a real guy. Okay? Not an imagination, but he claimed to be God. Now what's important about this is that, you know, there's a lot of religious leaders, right? You may say, well, Muhammad was a guy too. He was real. So was Buddha. Yeah. But they didn't claim to be God. Neither did Moses. Neither did all of these other religious leaders. None of them claimed to be God. What's interesting about that is many people will say, well, Jesus, you know, all religions kind of say about the same thing. And Jesus, you know, he was just another good, wise man, a good teacher. But here's the problem. He claimed to be God. So you can't just say he was a wise teacher unless you say that his claim was true, right? Let's say somebody walked up to you on the street and said, I'm God. What would you think of that person? You would think, either they're crazy, there's something wrong with them, or else they're just intentionally lying to me, right? Because I can look at you and see that you're not God, you're just some person. But the fact that Jesus claimed to be God is really important, and we're going to look at that a little bit more closely. But let's look at some of the places, because people will say, you know, Muslims believe in Jesus, okay? Muslims believe that Jesus was a prophet. They also believe that Jesus is returning, which is kind of interesting, because they don't believe that Muhammad is returning, but Jesus is returning. This is kind of interesting. But the point here is that Jesus claimed to be God. So in Mark 14, and this is the wrong verse. I thought that I had corrected it. It's actually 61. So Mark 14, 61 through 64. You know what Jesus was put to death for? Why he was crucified? It was because he claimed to be God. Now, if he didn't claim to be God, he wouldn't have been put to death. But we know, we had these historians who testified, both Roman and Jewish historians testified that he was put to death. Okay? Let's look at this passage here. And here's a little bit of a dialogue. So after that first line, the high priest. So this is the Jewish high priest. It's the Jewish religious leader. He's asking Jesus and saying, are you the Christ, the Son of the Blessed One? Now, let's just unpack those words a little bit. So these terms, you know, you hear about Jesus Christ, and you use those two terms all together. Jesus was actually his name, okay, just like my name is Nathanael. His name was Jesus. Christ is a title, okay? It means, in Hebrew, the term is Mashiach, or Messiah. It is the anointed one. Christ is the Greek form of that same word. It means the anointed one. And the Jewish people in the Old Testament, God had prophesied and said that there was going to come this ruler who is going to set the people free. He was going to do miracles. He was going to be king who would reign forever. And so when Jesus came and took that title on himself, that's like, whoa, hold on a second. This is a pretty big title. And so now the Jewish leaders are saying, wait a second. Are you claiming, first of all, that you are the Messiah? And not only that, are you claiming that you are the Son of... Now notice it says Blessed One. Jewish people were so afraid of saying God's name and even the word God, because one of the Ten Commandments is do not take the Lord's God's name in vain. So they were very careful and would not say God's name. So they built all of these other things up. And so that's why he said, are you the Christ, the Messiah? Are you the Son of the Blessed One? Are you the Son of God? Is that what you're claiming? And Jesus says, I am. There's no ambiguity there. He was claiming to be the Messiah. He was claiming to be the Son of God. And then he says, Jesus continues, and you will see the Son of Man. Now the Son of Man is another one of these special titles that he claimed for himself. It goes back to a prophecy in the Old Testament, several of them again talking about the Messiah, this ruler who is coming, and he was described as the Son of Man. That's why it's in capital there, because it's a title. It says, and you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the Mighty One coming in the clouds of heaven. So Jesus is saying, not only am I the Messiah, the Son of God, but you're going to see me coming, sitting at the right hand of God. And when the Jewish leaders heard this, they said, what? We don't need to hear anything more. We do not need any more witnesses, because he was on trial here, on trial, about to be put to death, seeing if he had done something that was worthy of being put to death. they said, "We do not need any more witnesses. You have heard the blasphemy. What do you think?" And they all condemned him as worthy of death. Because, and there's actually, John 10:30 was the one where Jesus said, "I and the Father are one." We are not, because Jesus asked them, "Why are you stoning me?" Because at this point, they're attacking and wanting to kill Jesus. And he said, "Why are you stoning me?" Jesus said, "I and the Father are one." And they said, "We're not stoning you because of your miracles or because of any good work, but because of blasphemy, because you, a mere man, claim to be God." Jesus over and over again made this claim that he was God. Jesus answered them and said, "Before Abraham was born, I am." That title, "I am," has two meanings. One, he's saying that he was existed before Abraham, who lived probably 3,000 years before that time. He said, "I was there." But also the "I am" is God's name. In the Old Testament, when Moses was being sent by God to go back and deliver the Israelite nation out of Egypt, he said, "Well, who should I tell them is sending me?" And God said, "Tell them I am is sending you." That was his, it's actually God's proper name, I am. And in Hebrew, that term, the closest that we can get to it is Yahweh. Yahweh, that is God's proper name. If you ever wanted to know, God's proper name is Yahweh. Jesus, the name Jesus, means Yahweh saves. Actually, Jesus is the Greek form. The Hebrew form is Yeshua. Yeshu. Yeh is Yahweh. Shua saves. That is his name. God's name is Yahweh. And Jesus claimed that he was God. So, you can't just say that Jesus was a good person, a good teacher, and get off the hook with that because he claimed to be God. And if he claimed to be God, he was either insane about who he was. You know, we've got people today who claim to be God. David Koresh claimed to be God. We have many people, probably if you go down to the psychiatric ward, I haven't been there myself, but Justin, have you ever been to the psychiatric ward?
Yes.
Have you ever met people who claim to be God?
Yes.
All right. There's someone who's been there and seen it. I've heard about it. I know that if you claim to be God, you're either a little confused or else you're intentionally deceiving people. So you can't say that Jesus is a good teacher because he claimed to be God. So either he's more than a good teacher, or else he's insane, or he's a liar. You can't have it both ways. Okay, we're going to look at this more as we go on. Let's go to the next slide. Okay, not only did Jesus claim to be God, not only was he a historical person, but he fulfilled over 300 prophecies in the Old Testament that were written about the coming Messiah. And most of them were ones that, like, he couldn't try to fulfill. They're either there or they're not. So, for instance, he couldn't, as a human, have any impact on where he was born, right? You're born where you're born. Your parents make that decision. You as an individual have no say in that matter. But Jesus was born in the city where the Messiah was supposed to be born. Not only that, I mean, it's kind of interesting because the Bible says that he was supposed to be born in Bethlehem, but then he was supposed to be called a Nazarene. If you've ever looked on a map of Israel, Bethlehem is way down south, and Nazareth is way up north. So how can you be born in Bethlehem, but be called a Nazarene? That just does not make sense unless you look at what happened in Jesus' life. He was down there being born in Bethlehem because the Roman governor had required there to be a tax that was paid. And so everybody had to return for a little bit to their hometown. And Joseph, his father's hometown, was Bethlehem. That's the place where his ancestors were from. So he had to go to Bethlehem. I mean, there's all kinds of stuff. And then it's like there was a prophecy that said, out of Egypt I will call my servant. It's like, well, if you're born in Bethlehem and you live in Nazareth, how on earth are you going to get called out of Egypt? That doesn't make any sense. Egypt is way down south further. Well, what happened was Herod, the king, was then starting to kill all the baby boys in Bethlehem, and God woke up Joseph in the middle of the night and said, flee to Egypt, because Herod is coming to kill the children. So they fled to Egypt. And then God said, okay, it's time to come back. So he fulfilled being born in Bethlehem, being called a Nazarene, and coming out of Egypt. I mean, at that time, people just did not travel like that. You know, this is not like today where you get on an airplane and fly to Egypt. You know, that is like a long ways. You know, you see the pictures of Mary and Joseph riding on the donkey. Well, just going from northern Israel to southern Israel is probably like a month-long journey if you're hobbling along on this donkey. Because it's mountainous, deserty, and she's pregnant. And then going down into Egypt just after having a baby. That just doesn't happen unless God is intervening. So another thing, just an amazing, one of the absolutely amazing prophecies of the Old Testament comes from Daniel 9:25. If you haven't ever seen this before, I urge you to go and look at it. Because this prophecy says that the Messiah will come 483 years after the time of the decree to rebuild Jerusalem. That's pretty specific, right? You get the number of years. This is 400 years before Jesus was born. This book of Daniel was written 400 years before Jesus was born, and God prophesied that the Messiah would come in 483 years. Now, we can go back and look at history, because the time that the decree was made to rebuild Jerusalem is also a historical event. It was done, the decree was made by King Ahasuerus. He's like a known king. There's historical records about him too, and about when it says in the second year of his reign, he did this. So you can go back and say, okay, second year. 483 years from that, guess where it brings you? Right to Jesus' lifetime. Dun, 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 dun. Now, you may not believe much about the Bible, but I want to tell you that, along with many other prophecies, and in fact, people who are scholars who think that the Bible isn't true, say the book of Daniel had to be written after the fact, because there are hundreds hundreds of prophecies in there that talk about what this country will do, what this king will do. It describes and prophesies the next four civilizations that are going to be coming onto the earth. And the historians look and say, there's no way that that could have been written back then, because how would they know that next the Greeks, and then the Medes, and then the Persians, and the Romans were going to come? There's no way for somebody to know that. But God knew that. Daniel is one of those books that really demonstrates the divine authority of Scripture. Because the thing is that they say, well, it had to be written after the fact. The problem is that there are scrolls that were found in the Dead Sea, in Qumran, in caves, that were from 200 and some odd BC. And all of them testify to these times. And Jesus came at the time and the place where the Bible testified and prophesied that he would come. That's pretty solid evidence. So he was born to a virgin, you know, like, hello, anybody here born to a virgin? Okay, that's pretty unique. Tribe of Judah, okay, that tribe wasn't very big, but he was there. The Bible said that he would speak in parables, perform miracles, that he would be betrayed, that he would be killed, his clothes would be divided, his bones would not be broken, that he would be pierced. I mean, it described in detail. If you go and read Psalm 22, you're going to be like, wow, somebody had like Jesus' diary beforehand. This is written like probably 2,000 years before Jesus, and you read it, and it's like, wow, they read his mail. It sounds like, you know, Jesus' blog from that day after the crucifixion. But no, this was God's word. And not only that, but the scripture proclaimed that he would rise from the dead. Which he did. Let's go to the next slide. Now, the fact that he rose from the dead is something that if you look at the historical evidence, it is absolutely undeniable. Okay? I want this to sink in for a minute. If you look at the historical evidence for Jesus rising from the dead, the evidence clearly, clearly proclaims that he rose from the dead. But how could that happen? How can that be? Well, let's take a look at some of the evidence here. First of all, Jesus' tomb is still there and it's empty. Okay? So, we'll look at what's important about that in a minute. But what's really interesting is that the Bible describes that women were the first ones to go and find the tomb empty. Now think about this. If the disciples were making up a story and proclaiming Jesus rising from the dead, who would have been the ones who found Jesus and the tomb empty? Any guesses? They were making up a story. Who would have found him?
Peter.
Yeah, he was the head apostle. He'd be the hero. He would have been the one to find it if they made it up. But consider this. At that time in history, it's not a good thing, but it is true that at that time in history, a woman's testimony was not, it did not have any weight in a court case. If you went before a court, a woman's testimony held no weight. Now, obviously, that's very wrong, but if they were going to make something up, there's no way that they Jesus's mother, there was Mary, the other Mary, there was a few Marys who went, I don't remember who they all were. But they were the ones who went to the tomb. They were going to go and wrap him and prepare him for burial because they didn't have time the day before because it was a holy holiday. They weren't supposed to touch any dead bodies or else they wouldn't have been able to participate in the Passover, which is, you know, a big deal. So they just, his body was put away, and so then they were going a few days later to wrap his body properly with all the spices and all the things that they would do, and they get to the tomb and it's empty. They're like, oh, who stole his body? And the disciples come, and John and Peter, they come, and they're doubting, oh no, this can't be. If they were making up that story, you know, Peter would have been, oh yeah, I knew it all along, Jesus said it, and I believed him. But no, this is a historical account of what happened, okay? The tomb is empty. And as we saw before, we could look, there's many biblical, of course, accounts of the tomb being empty, but we also saw that there are non-biblical ones, like Josephus, the Jewish historian, testified that Jesus rose from the dead in 3 days. So think about this. The tomb is empty. So you only have a couple of options here. If the tomb is empty, that means either that he never died. Well, we've got a lot of testimony that said that he died. And so that one is not too likely. It could be that somebody stole his body, right? The tomb is empty. So let's just say, let's go through the possibilities here. So one possibility is the disciples came and they stole Jesus' body from the tomb and then told everybody that Jesus rose from the dead, right? That would be one of the possibilities. Here's the problem. In fact, that is the story that the Romans said, okay, let's tell everybody that this is what happened. But here's the deal. First of all, his tomb was guarded by Roman soldiers, okay? And when Roman soldiers were put in charge of watching something, it's their life for the life of who they're guarding. If that person gets away, they're going to die, okay? Now, the disciples were, you know, fishermen, an accountant, a few people like that. There was nobody who was a soldier. And so they're going to be coming and overpowering these Roman guards who have like swords and are trained in battle. And then, by the way, that if something happens, they're going to die. Okay, not very likely. But second of all, let's think about the implications of that. If the disciples stole his body, that would mean that they knew that Jesus didn't rise from the dead, right? So if they knew that Jesus didn't rise from the dead, you know that almost all of the disciples were themselves put to death because they believed that Jesus Christ rose from the dead. Now, people are going to die for something that they believe to be true. So, for instance, you'll see people who are Muslims, you know, like bombers or what are they called? What kind of bombers? Suicide bombers, thank you. They'll strap some things on. They'll die for that. You know, you see Christians who know that, you know, they believe that this is God and they're going to die for that. In fact, you even have people who are deceived. So some of you may or may not know of this guy named Jim Jones. He claimed to be God. He deceived a whole bunch of people down in South America, went down there, and they eventually all killed themselves by drinking this great Kool-Aid. reason that they did that, they killed themselves, is because they believed that this was the truth. People will die for something they believe to be true, but they will not die for something they know to be a lie. If the disciples knew that Jesus didn't rise from the dead, they would have simply said, okay, before you put me to death here, just let me say a few things. Okay, this whole bit about Jesus rising from the dead, well, that didn't happen. You know, that's all they would have had to say, and then they wouldn't have been killed. So people are willing to die for something that they believe is true, but they are absolutely unwilling to die for something that they know is a lie. So it doesn't make sense that the disciples took his body. Another option is, let's say, the Romans, or perhaps even the Jewish people, took Jesus' body. And now the disciples think, whoa, he rose from the dead! And it's a miracle! But the Romans really just took his body. Well, here's the thing, that doesn't make sense either, because if the Christians then started going around claiming, Jesus rose from the dead! He rose from the dead! And in fact, we've seen him. Well, that's another argument against that, because then they saw him alive. He appeared not only to one and two, but to all 12, and then to 500 people at a time. Okay, so they saw him alive. So that kind of throws off all of those other arguments. But let's just put that aside for a second. Now, if the Romans or the Jewish persons came and stole Jesus' body, when the Christians then were claiming and they were growing in size and becoming an irritation to both the Romans and the Jewish leaders, all the Romans or the Jewish leaders would have to do is bring out Jesus' body and say, he didn't rise from the dead. He's right here. That would have ended all of the question or the debate. Christianity would have ended. If they had taken his body, they could easily produce it. When the Christians were claiming that Jesus rose from the dead, that would have just ended it. So clearly they didn't have the body. And they wrote about the fact that he rose from the dead. And they were antagonistic towards this whole story. They thought, these guys are heretics. But they couldn't deny that Jesus did miracles and that he rose from the dead because he did it publicly. And there were witnesses, many of them. So it makes no sense that Jesus didn't die. It makes no sense that the Romans or the Jewish people took his body. It makes no sense that the disciples took his body. The tomb is still there and it's empty. So we're running out of options here. And in fact, the only logical reason that you could say that the tomb is empty, and in fact the historical evidence points to this fact, that Jesus in fact rose from the dead. Jesus rose from the dead. Now, if you make a claim and say you're God, and you're just a regular person down the street, people are going to go, well, you're crazy. But if you make a claim and say you're God, and then you go around healing people, opening the eyes of the blind, making people who were lame and making them walk, and then you say that you're going to be put to death and then rise from the dead, and then, in fact, that happens. He was put to death, and then he rose from the dead. That now brings us to the point where we need to seriously consider his claim that he is God. Because now he is given really convincing evidence for this case. So the question then, was Jesus a liar? Did he make it up? Did he make up the fact that he was God? Was he lying to the disciples? Well, if he was lying to the disciples, clearly all of the miracles and the rising from the dead, they kind of show us that there was something behind his claims. In fact, he was held by people who don't even believe in Jesus, that he is God. If you talk to most people and ask them, what do you think about Jesus? They would say, well, he was a pretty wise, good ethical or moral teacher, is what they would say. Now, I've talked to a lot of people. So I went to college at UC Berkeley, which, if you're familiar with that, isn't like known as a bastion, a stronghold of Christianity. But I'll tell you what, there's a lot more Christians there than you would think, and I'll tell you about that in some of the following weeks. When I had my physics teacher in my hardest physics class, at the end of the class, at the end of the year, he gave his testimony of why he was an atheist, and as he studied physics and quantum mechanics, he became utterly convinced that there was a God, and then became utterly convinced that Jesus is God. I tell you, that's kind of a surprising thing when your physics teacher at UC Berkeley gives his testimony. It was like, woo! In fact, then I found out there was a whole bunch of Christians on faculty. Anyhow, we'll talk about that more later. The point is here that Jesus demonstrated that he was not a liar, and he wasn't a lunatic. He had people following him. Now, people who are crazy, they'll have followers sometimes for a little bit. They can deceive them. But Jesus' words are recorded and known to be wise. He demonstrated that, in fact, he is no liar. He is not a lunatic. But, in fact, he is God. So let's move on to the next slide. So not only has Jesus in history demonstrated that he is God, but if you look at the world today, people's lives are still being changed by an encounter with Jesus. And I stand before you today not because of the historical arguments, not because I don't believe in Jesus, because I was talked into it by looking at the historical or scientific evidence, although I love looking at that stuff, and I think it's really cool, and I love debating people. I've done that a lot on college campuses, and it's fun. But I'm telling you, the reason that I believe in Jesus is that I have met him. He forgave my sins. He changed my heart. He changed my life. He speaks to me today. He is alive. I have seen him do miracles, and I don't mean just the little miracles, which I am very thankful for, like going to the mall and praying, God, give me a good parking spot, and you know, I get one right in front of the store. Awesome! A miracle! Oh, it's a small miracle. But I've seen God do things like someone has cancer. There's an x-ray. They're going in to do surgery to remove that cancer. They get prayed for. They go in the next day to prep for surgery. They do another scan, and it's gone. They go, what happened? They've got the before picture and the after picture, and there's nothing scientifically that can explain what happened, but I'll tell you what happened is that God is alive today, and He is healing and changing lives today. He is the living and true God. And that is why I follow Him. And that is why many people follow Him. And so the question today for each one of us is, what about you? What about me? In light of the evidence of who Jesus is, of His claims, of the historical evidence, of His power to change lives. And you may be saying, yeah, but Nathanael, I just don't know enough about Jesus. I don't know enough about Him. Well, my statement to you is, you don't have to know all about Him. He knows all about you. And what He's saying today is, come and follow me. Come and follow me. Jesus is the way to life. He is the way to hope. He is the way to newness. So I want to close in prayer right now. And if you're someone who has never met Jesus, if you have not given your life to Him, then I would give you this challenge. Just try Jesus. I'm not asking you to go to Africa or give any money. I'm not asking you to do anything. I'm asking you to give Him a try. To say, Lord Jesus, if you are real, show yourself to me. I want to follow you. If you are real, if you are really God, I want to follow you. So let's pray right now. Lord, in Jesus' name, I pray to be able to follow you. I pray, Lord God, that you will open up my eyes to see you. I pray, Lord Jesus, that if you are real, that you will show yourself right now to each person here, for the one who has the question, for the one who has the doubt, for the one who is uncertain. I pray is that, Lord God, as they pray, that you would hear and that you would answer and that you would show yourself as the living and true and real God to them. So let's pray. Pray after me these simple words. Lord Jesus, I want to know you. Please show yourself to me. Please forgive me of my sins, because I am a sinner. I have lied. I've hated. I've been jealous. I've done so many things wrong. But Lord Jesus, forgive me now. Change my heart. Let me become your child. Amen. Lord, I pray for those who prayed that prayer, that you will speak to them, that you will take off their sins in the past. I pray that you will heal them. Though if you've made a commitment for the first time to the Lord Jesus, I'd encourage you to either come forward now and I'll pray with you some more, or I'd encourage you to talk to somebody who is a believer in Jesus and just tell them. Tell them about what you've done. And for those of us who believe in Jesus, let's pray and ask Him to build our confidence and certainty on the rock, that we would not waver in doubt or in fear, but have confidence that He who is the truth, that His truth will never be overcome. Because He is the truth. So Lord Jesus, I pray in Jesus' name that, Father God, that you would pour out your Spirit on us today, and I pray that you would give us a spirit of boldness. Boldness, Lord God, to proclaim to those around us that, Jesus, you're alive. Jesus, you are God. Jesus, you have the power to change lives today. I pray, Lord God, that you would take away our fears and take away the lies, Lord God, that have backed us down, because, Lord Jesus, you are the truth. And there is nothing, Lord God, that can remove that, you, from the fact that you are a God, that you rose from the dead, and that you are changing lives today. Let us be certain of that. Let us proclaim that you, Lord Jesus, are God. Let us grow in our faith and our confidence in you. And so we bless your name, and we thank you. In Jesus' mighty name.